Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Greg Walsh. I'm the Emergency Preparedness Manager for the City of Salem. And I'm here today to talk to you about being prepared for all types of emergencies and disasters as an individual, as a household, and as a community. So one of the first things I always start with is telling you our promise as responders. It's truly that we're responders. Our job is to come help, and we will, and we'll do everything we can. But in some disasters that we could potentially face here in the Pacific Northwest, it could take a while. It could take a day. It could take up to 2 weeks, depending on the type of disaster. So the thing that we ask everybody is that they consider being 2 weeks ready. And that's a big program we have here in the Pacific Northwest with the intent that everybody would be self-sufficient for about 2 weeks or more, if necessary. And there's a reason for that. So emergency preparedness should be a priority for everyone. I know everybody has plenty of priorities already in their life, but this is something that only takes minutes out of every day or minutes a week. So emergencies and disasters truly affect us all. Think about it. Have you ever had a car accident where you lost your vehicle and you couldn't use it for a couple days? Have you ever had a home fire or know somebody that has? There are plenty of things that we face on a daily basis that are personal, individual, or household disasters. But my job is really to consider bigger disasters, the bigger things that we plan for, such as flooding, earthquakes, maybe a volcanic activity. How about snowstorms? These are all things that are part of my job. Now, the way that I do it is plans. The way that you can help is by being prepared. Truly, being part of the solution is one of the greatest things that we can ask you to do, is that there are plenty of people that can't get prepared for some reason or other. So if you can get prepared, we ask you to, because we will have to focus on other people who can't, whether it's their living situation, the amount of money that they make, the amount of space that they have. There's plenty of reasons that people can't get prepared, but if you can, we truly ask you to. And you know, at the bottom of the slide, it asks this great question, and really, being prepared to help not only yourself and your loved ones and your neighbors, but if you couldn't get there because you were at work and you were separated from your family, wouldn't you want your neighbors to be willing and able to help take care of your family until you get home? Think about that. The most important question I can ask you is, who depends on you? Is it children, pets, parents, elderly, neighbors, family, anybody else that is in your local community? They might depend on you. I mean, if you think about it, if you're the person that anytime something goes wrong in somebody else's life, you're the one that gets the phone call, whether it's somebody cuts their hand or somebody is having an individual emergency, if they call you, if somebody calls you, somebody else depends on you. Even if it's just the simple, everything's gonna be all right. But those people depend on you in little things. They'll certainly depend on you when the big things happen. So being prepared to help everybody that depends on you. And, you know, when you talk about pets, they can't get prepared. They can't walk to the store and get an extra bag of dog food or store some water. Same thing with small children. You can get them involved and have them do their own and get engaged and have them become prepared and help the preparedness process. But they can't just go to the store and buy extra food or store water. So make sure you consider that. So the steps to disaster planning, pretty straightforward. It's first off, find out what disasters we face. And small disasters are the easiest ones to start with. Create that family plan for what are you gonna do as a whole family or the people you live with, your friends, and the people that depend on you. Build your kit. Now this is the part that gets rather more difficult, a little bit more time consuming, but there's easy ways to get around that. And I'll talk about those throughout this presentation. Practice and maintain, you know, check on your supplies, make sure your fire detectors are working, your smoke detectors, your fire extinguishers are all working. That's part of that practice and maintain thing. But hopefully you get prepared and you never actually have to put it into practice. You have a plan, you have a kit, but you never have to use it. I hope so. But would you rather be prepared? I'm sure I would. In the Pacific Northwest, the question I usually ask is, what hazards don't we face? We have the potential for earthquakes, and I'll talk about that throughout this presentation, but the city of Salem and the surrounding areas flood on a regular basis. Volcanic activity It's a potential. Winter storms, wind storms. Over the last several weeks, this is January of 2020, and over the last several weeks, we've had snow, we've had high winds, we've had plenty of tree branches come down and have to call out responders to get people out there. Wildfires, house fire, as I mentioned earlier, can be your own personal disaster. Terrorism is something that could happen. Active shooters happen, and we are the state capital here in Salem, so having that as consideration and being aware of your surroundings is incredibly important. If you're out at the coast vacationing, tsunamis are a significant concern. Industrial accidents happen all the time. Whether that's a truck rolls over, a rail car has an accident, any type of industrial accident could affect you and become your own disaster. Pandemic disease and heat advisory, all things that we really, really consider and plan for. But again, these are all things that you should consider as an individual or a household to have these conversations and plan for them. So the big thing that we fear here, reasonably so, this is what I spend a lot of my time doing, is talking about the Cascadia Fault subduction zone type earthquake. Now, if you don't know about it, it's this earthquake fault line that runs off the coast of California all the way up through Canada. And this potential earthquake, this fault line, we know happens off the coast, and I'll show you how often, but we know that it happens on a regular basis, and the potential is a 9.0 or greater earthquake. That's significant. That's like what we saw in Japan or in Chile or in Nepal. These are significant earthquakes that create complete shifts in the way of life. Now, on the chart there, we see this is a chart from the Oregon Resilience Plan, and it depicts some time frames that we expect to see after Cascadia. Now, if you read those, it's not very reassuring, because when you look at drinking water and sewer, it's 1 month to 1 year. That's significant. The city of Salem's water system was built in the 30s, and it's in Staten and runs 30 some odd miles into our water system proper. There are two pipelines that run from there. One was built in the 30s, one was built in the 50s. Now, that was before we knew about Cascadia. Of course, we've made improvements and repairs since then, but it's still not a fully seismically stable system. And we know that, we've had assessments on that. And throughout the entire city, we haven't gone through and ripped up every pipe of water and sewer to replace it with a seismic pipe. It's very time consuming and difficult to do that process. So having that consideration of it may be a while before water is regularly flowing through your tap again is very important to consider. Now, there are other things to look at there. Healthcare facilities could be up to 18 months. It's significant. So having a plan for these different things is very, very important, and we'll talk about how we plan for this. When we look at Cascadia, this is a nice chart that shows the last 5,000 years of Cascadia history. And we are at the number one here, that's counting up, and we're at 320 years in 2020. We know the last time Cascadia happened was January 26th of 1700, so quite literally 320 years ago. When we look at 5,000 years, we see that out of all of that, only one time has it climbed past the 320 years we're at now to 330 years. Overwhelmingly, we see these earthquakes at a shorter interval. Now, earthquake science isn't perfect. As you can see, there are some points where it was only 64 years between earthquake events. So, are we on borrowed time? Potentially. Is this a really good reason to plan for it? Absolutely. Because we know it has the potential to happen any day, any time. And having a plan and being ready for it is so very, very important. So if Cascadia happened tomorrow, what do we have to work with? Well, the city of Salem has about 170,000 residents. There are about 60,000 people that commute into the city every day and about 40,000 people that live in the unincorporated areas of Salem. And so for about 270,000 people in our area and surrounding areas, the city of Salem has about 1,300 employees. At any given time, we might have 41 to 44 firefighters on duty, about 40 police officers, and 20 EMTs. Now, we have a lot more in at home, off shift, off duty, that would help respond, but when you think about those numbers, 270,000 people have about 100 first responders on duty for them. Those aren't great odds. And that's why we ask you to be prepared, have a plan, learn some first aid, be situationally aware. If you're in a bad situation, try to get away from it. So, as I said at the beginning, we will do everything we can to help. It's just going to take some time because there are going to be a lot of people in need. So planning for that and having that consideration is crucial. So now that we've talked about why we need to plan, and Cascadia, of course, is the big one. If we get prepared for Cascadia, then we are prepared for the little things like a house fire or, you know, an industrial accident, flooding. By having that little level of preparedness, we can really improve our own lives. So creating a plan, why do we plan? Bad things happen. Disasters happen all the time, every day. We have a fully employed fire and police department that respond to individual and household disasters every day. So building that next level, it happens. Making sure everybody in your family knows what to do, because you may be separated from each other. If you are at work, your loved ones are at school or at work or separated from you, went on a hike at one of the many parks that Salem has to offer, you may not be readily accessible to get home. So having a plan for what each person will do, where you will meet, how will you get home. And don't forget about pets. Everywhere you go. Personally, I have a dog, and I know in my car I keep an extra bag of dog food, a little Ziploc bag of dog food, as well as my backpack for the rest of my kit, so I can get home if I have to, if I'm away from home and I can't use the roads. With the potential for this earthquake, we could look at loss of water, sewer, gas lines, power lines, phone and cell towers, road systems could be damaged, bridges could be damaged, and a lot of buildings and infrastructure could be significantly damaged. So making sure that we have plans to get home, communicate with people, or just know what to do without being able to call them and ask them, where are we gonna meet? It's so, so very important that it's a regular part of our plans. And these are things that go into our plans. So there's plenty of reasons, of course, why we don't prepare. One of the first things I said is make it a priority. I have so many priorities in my life that doing this is, hard to add another priority. But it only takes a few minutes every day or a couple minutes a week, and you can start to get prepared. One of the other things that I always hear is, I don't want to look like a prepper. I don't want to be considered like I'm a freak. I'm preparing for this thing that may never happen. The way I look at my preparedness supplies is truly as a physical savings account. I have a savings account because bad things happen and I might need to repair my car or something else. But if there were no stores to go to, if I couldn't take out my money from an ATM because there's no power, and if I got to the store and it was all picked over and I know that there's no resupply coming for a couple days or weeks, then I know I at least have what I need to be okay at home. It's really just a physical savings account of having what I need to be comfortable in my own home and not have to worry about getting out to other people. Now, that's great for my wife and dog. For me, it's my job to come and respond. So I'll be working nonstop because this is my job to help the community respond and recover from an event like this. But making sure that you can be okay for a couple days is super important. How do we create a plan? First things first, meet with your family and discuss disaster preparedness. It's not always fun to talk to your family about massive disasters or being separated during an earthquake or floods or even volcanic events, a wildfire. But having that discussion with your family really sets the groundwork to make sure people know why we're doing it and what for. Talk about those disasters, what to do in each, where would you evacuate to, where would you meet? Who are you going to try to contact? If you have kids at a school and you work on the other side of one of the streams or rivers, or you work in Portland, who's going to pick them up? How are they going to get home? What's the plan for that? Talking about those meeting places. If you can't get home easily, how are you going to meet? Where are you going to meet? Take some training if you can. This is just an introductory training to all of the more in-depth things that we can get. CERT is our community emergency response team. That's 21 hours of free training that the city puts on. And that's how to be prepared individually, how to do some first aid, search and rescue, radio communications. It's really a big program about neighbors helping neighbors in emergencies. Learn some CPR, take some basic first aid. Also, insurance is something that can really help you. After Hurricane Harvey hit Texas, we know that the average payout to a home was somewhere between $8,000 and $13,000 that were flooded homes. Now, I know I personally can't rebuild or repair my home with $8,000. So having insurance really makes an incredible difference in recovery of these events. So at a minimum, these are some of the things that are just the baseline things that we want to have, is having that emergency documentation. So copies of your IDs, phone numbers written down, medical information. Does anybody have allergies? Do you take medications? Great tip here is peel the medical labels off your bottles and stick them into a booklet so you can keep that. Have a disaster kit. This is that big building a kit program, and I'll get into this a lot more later, but having food, water, medications, and some form of shelter really helps you be comfortable. You know, could you camp in your backyard for up to 2 weeks if you needed to? Conducting a home hazard hunt. This is really just simply going around your home, securing bookshelves, TVs, anything to the wall, pictures to the wall, to make sure that if you had to run out while your house is shaking, or try to get out while your house is shaking, or afterwards, that things wouldn't fall on you and create a bigger injury or a bigger problem. Install and maintain working smoke detectors. Now, the question I ask every time I do this presentation to a group is, who has done a fire evacuation drill in their own home in the last 5 years? That's an easy one. It takes 5 minutes to say, hey family, in an emergency, we're gonna meet at the end of our driveway by the fire hydrant. Anything, and having that discussion. Overwhelmingly, maybe 10% of the population has actually done a fire drill with their home in the last 5 years. It takes 5 minutes. That's something everybody can do tonight. You could do it tomorrow, you could do it over the weekend. But have that discussion. Where would we meet? Who has what responsibilities? Who's grabbing the pets? Who's propping the door open so the cats can get out if they're running out of the fire? If you have a cat or an animal that's in a cage, who's grabbing that animal? Right? This is so important, and this truly just helps the fire department, because you can say, hey, I know that this person is still in the home because they haven't gotten to our meeting place. And it helps direct first responders. Another great thing is to know when and how to turn off your gas, electricity, and water. And that's a great skill that we teach in CERT. You can learn how to do that rather quickly. But in many, many events, knowing how to do those three things, turn off those shutoffs to your home, can really help your home from damage. So what makes that family plan? Communication. This is by far one of the hardest things, especially when we talk about the Cascadia earthquake. Because if there's no cell phones, which we all rely on every day now, how are you going to communicate with your family? Part of it is setting that expectation, having those conversations ahead of time so they know what to do in each event and they're not relying on cell phones. You know, what else? There may be no internet. So having a plan, having a radio system. The city employs ham radio volunteers as part of our community emergency response team. That's a great asset that we have to communicate all across the city. Having a plan, as I mentioned before, how are your kids getting home from school? What are those meeting places? Who is in your area that can help you? Meeting your neighbors. It sounds scary. I know a lot of people that don't want to ever talk to their neighbors. But find out who your neighbors are. You may have a doctor next door. You may have a plumber. You may have somebody that can truly provide a great capability to you in an emergency. And by working together, you can build a community of preparedness. So when it comes to communications, you could be anywhere. And having a plan on how you're going to make sure the people you care about know you're safe, or getting back to them and getting prepared and doing that understanding makes all the difference. You know, for my wife and I, this is just a backup plan that we have, is that we actually, in both of our cars, we have bright pink duct tape with unicorns and rainbows on it and a Sharpie duct taped in, rolled into the duct tape. And we know that if we had to evacuate our home, Now, like I said, it's my job. I'll be responding. So if my wife is home and she has to evacuate and leave for some reason, she can put that tape on our door and then quite literally do a duct tape breadcrumb trail all the way to wherever she's going and leave notes for me of when and where she's going. And that's just a way that I could potentially find her after we start to recover and I can go start really looking for her and trying to find her and meet up with her. Now, if you're more quickly trying to find your family, it may be as simple as everybody just get home, get to the school, get to the high school, go to our church. Think of those considerations. One of the things we always recommend is having an out-of-state or out-of-area contact number. The Cascadia Subduction Zone earthquake has the potential to really reach impact most of the West Coast up through the Cascades region. So if we're talking about on the other side of the Cascades, they may be okay. Phones may be in contact. And you may be able to have a little bit of cell service. Spotty, it may work. We may be able to set up cell towers on wheels. And you may be able to, at that point, text somebody out of the region. And if you're separated from your family, letting one person that's not affected know, that can gather all of the information of, oh, Greg's doing okay, he's at work, his wife is at home with the dog. You know, that's something that if they can communicate it back to us, at least we know, and it helps us have that peace of mind is that other people are okay. So being able to reach out of state or out of the region can be incredibly useful in a lot of disasters. School plans. If you have children, make a plan for it. There are plenty of types of emergencies where schools have been on lockdown or had to be evacuated. And hopefully it's something that they could, if they evacuate, they go back into the school because it's safe. In some earthquake situations, children cannot go back into the schools. So if it's January and it's raining or snowing and the kids have to evacuate, what is their plan? Can they walk home? Is there somebody nearby that they can go shelter with and be taken care of instead of a teacher who has 26 plus other students? Having that plan with your kids and having that conversation or the other responsible adults that could take care of or pick up your kids is super critical. So having that plan and making sure you have a plan for this should be a basic part of your emergency plan. Having meeting places identified or alternate meeting places. And this goes back to something as simple as a fire. If you have a house fire, having that meeting place outside of your home is very important, or your apartment complex. Where are you going to go? And then have the discussion of alternates. What happens if you can't get there? Pick a second place. Outside your home is a great option. You know, neighbor's yard, away from anything that could be a hazard. One of the other things that we really consider is, especially during earthquakes, when things start to fall down, people look for wide open spaces that don't have a lot to fall on them. And overwhelmingly, people survive earthquakes, including the potential for this Cascadia earthquake. We expect most of the population to survive okay throughout the initial event and the aftershocks, but it's the aftermath that people will struggle with, and that's having the food, water, etc., to continue living comfortably. So we expect people to gather at large parking lots, places of worship, parks, schools, whether it's fields, the parking lots, other areas that they feel comfortable or safe from. And that's where, honestly, we plan to start trying to provide resources, whether it's food, water, medication. That's part of what the large scale response is to Cascadia, is reaching out and getting to large centers where population groups have gathered. That's part of the plan. Hopefully you're okay and you're not reliant on other people or you're not reliant on the government showing up, because even as part of the Cascadia plan, the 2 weeks ready plan comes from that whole concept that it could take up to 2 weeks to mobilize and get enough resources into the region to be providing food and water to the entire population in 2 weeks. And that's a lot. That's a lot of food and water. So having it on your own can really make the difference between living comfortably or living very uncomfortably, starving and struggling. So being prepared for yourself and your neighbors and other people that depend on you, this is part of it. Assign responsibilities and give people purpose, especially when it comes to kids or family members or friends. Give people something to do. Whether it's get the evacuation, who's doing the pet evacuation and care, who's grabbing the first aid kit, who's moving the car if you have to, who's potentially turning off utilities. These are all things that can go into your plan and be part of the practice. Now, I will say, if you learn how to turn off your utilities, don't just do it for practice. Because if you turn your utilities off, you often have to have them inspected before you do. If you take CERT training, though, we do actually teach you how to turn off gas meters and water meters, as well as electric boxes, the different types. So that's a great option. It's free training, again, and you can find that through the City of Salem's website. So now that we've talked about what goes into that plan, and this is just some of the basics, how do we build a kit? And this is, honestly, easier than you may think, because you may already have most of what you need. The first question I always ask is, how many people have gone camping? We're in Oregon, we're in the Pacific Northwest. It is amazing to camp here. You might have a tent and sleeping bags and some shelter, cooking equipment, camping food. Right there, you have a lot of what you need right on hand. So gathering some of that equipment, gathering some of that stuff, putting it into a bucket or two buckets and putting it somewhere where you can get to it after an emergency. That can save you and be the best start to a kit, because then you have what you shelter right off the bat. Fishing, you may have fishing equipment, gloves, wet weather gear, raincoats, waders, other things that will keep you comfortable in adverse weather. Traveling. If you're like me, you probably have an empty suitcase somewhere in your house. Almost everybody I've ever talked to has that empty suitcase that they used on vacation, they brought it back, they emptied it out, and now it's sitting on a shelf. Having a suitcase full of an extra set of clothes, some basic supplies, an extra pair of socks, shoes, and having that where you could easily grab it can be a really great start to a kit. This is also something we talk about that can be incredibly useful when we talk about being prepared in your car. Now, personally, I have a backpack in my car because I know I can put a backpack on and I can walk 10 miles a day pretty comfortably. So for me, I have a backpack. But for a lot of people who may not be able to put a backpack on and walk quite as far with the additional weight, having that suitcase with wheels on it in the back of your car, change of clothes, change of shoes, some food, some water, snacks, a space blanket, put it in there. If you need to evacuate your car or abandon your car for some reason, you can pull it out. You have something with wheels on it, you have your supplies, and it's a lot easier than carrying it, dragging it with wheels. I also have yard work on the slide because having tools, gloves, other things that can save you from injury or help you dig through or rebuild your home can be incredibly important. Now, starting simple. These are the basics. These are the things that we will always need. Water, by far and away, is one of the most important things. The human body can only survive 3 days without water or fluids. So if you drink soda or Gatorade or whatever your preferred fluid is, make sure you have that on hand. Now, we recommend water because you can do a lot more with it. You can make coffee, you can make tea. So if you drink caffeine on a regular basis, having a plan for caffeine and not having a caffeine headache is also incredibly important and will really help people be a little bit more happy to work with you. But water is also used for cleaning, brushing your teeth, washing your hands, cooking. We plan for a gallon of water per person per day for 14 days. And that's a lot. I completely understand that. And there are plenty of ways you can do that. You can put them in containers. You can get 55-gallon drums. For us at home, for me, my wife, and my dog, we have a 55-gallon drum of water. And I know, there we go. I have enough water in one container for the three of us for the 15-plus days. Now, we also have some 6-gallon containers because you can't really move a 55-gallon drum. But we can put some of our 6-gallon containers in a wagon and drag it behind us if we have to leave home. You can also use water purifiers or tablets. There's water filters and purifiers. I always encourage water purifiers because they go to a smaller level of filtration, which can take out things like Giardia and other organisms that can cause upset stomachs, other sicknesses that you don't necessarily want if you're already in a bad situation with limited water. And then stored water. And what I mean by this is getting bottled water or gallons of water that are pre-sealed. You buy them from the store and those will last quite a while, but take up a little bit more space. Now, the big thing with this is pay attention to your water. If it's not climate controlled, we recommend changing your water every 6 to 12 months. Especially if you fill up from a city tap where our water is already chlorinated, it'll last quite a while without having to be changed out. Now, if you feel uncomfortable about that, change it out more regularly. When it comes to bottled water, that will often last for 2 to 3 years. After that, yes, water bottles often have an expiration date, and that's because the plastic may leach into the water based on the heat and temperature changes. But when it comes down to it, I would rather drink some funky tasting water than not have water at all. So plan for water. 1 gallon of water per person per day, including pets, and that's for cooking, cleaning, washing, and everything else that you could imagine. So having water, by far and away, is so incredibly important. When it comes to food, there's a lot of great options out there for emergency food. Now, you can get emergency food, you can get camping food, and you can just do the food that you regularly have around home. The first thing I recommend is to look at what you already have. You may already have 5 to 10 days of food on hand at home, whether it's cans of soup, jars of peanut butter, regular produce that you go through on a regular basis. Now, that's one of the easiest ways to start. See what you have, and then build on that. If you have peanut butter on a regular basis, next time you go to the store, buy 1 extra container of it. And just have a little bit more projected out, a little bit more on hand, that you'll eventually go through too, which helps with that whole rotation of it, and that's not just stored for an emergency and you may never use it and it might go bad. So get things that you already use. Now, camping food, you can find some that has a 25-year shelf life on it. And that's great. I have plenty of that. I also have MREs from the military, but we have a lot of canned food as well. And we also just have a lot of food in our home. Just stocking up some simple things can make a huge difference. Now, having snacks, especially when children have preferred snacks, having those things that they can snack on can be really important for distraction and also to kind of make people happy. Utensils and dish soap, keeping clean and sanitary. This is another thing to have some serious consideration behind. Having a few pots or pans, some utensils, do you have a spatula? Do you have a ladle? Do you have a camp stove? Do you have these things that you can cook? Even a gas grill that you have outside, if you can recover it and it's in a safe spot, there's a great way to cook. But having the ability to cook something or boil water may make a huge difference. But being able to clean it makes a bigger difference, because if you continue to use dirty or unclean cooking equipment, you could become sick. And if we're already short on water, short on food, getting sick is not a good option. And a little bit of dish soap goes a long way in preparing for that. Also, protein powder, high nutrition bars, emergency rations. Those are all great things. Rice and beans. You can buy large bags of that for under $100, and it can last 15 days if you ration and you do it appropriately. Now, considering clothing and footwear. In Oregon, it rains, it snows, it could be 60 one day and 30 the next day. So making sure you have some footwear and clothing appropriate for the season, and footwear you could walk miles in. And the big thing here is if you could actually think about how would you get home from work in whatever shoes that you have on right now. Now, one of the best solutions to this is keep an extra pair of old running shoes or an extra pair of shoes in your car. More likely than not, you got to work somehow. You probably drove, or in most places that you go, you probably drove. So keeping that extra pair of shoes in your car will really help you when it comes time to how do I get home? And can I walk home in whatever I'm wearing? And that also helps if you have a bag at work. If you take public transportation, you ride a bike, you commute or otherwise, having a kit at work can also make a huge difference and really help. First aid kit with instructions, but please learn some first aid first. Learn actually how to stop bleeding, apply a tourniquet, pack a wound, even just how to appropriately address shock. These are all things that YouTube is magical and has plenty of other resources on this, but we teach all of this in CERT as well, and there's a number of other programs that you can take and learn some basic first aid. Now, other things that you'll need or want is bedding, appropriate for the season. So, like I said at the beginning, if you've gone camping, you probably have a sleeping bag or maybe a ground pad or some resource that would help you be more comfortable camping outside. You know, could you camp in your backyard for 2 weeks without having to go back into your home? Possibly. If your home's generally okay, you might want to shelter in your own home because it will provide some extra protection and warmth and comfort in your home. You know, sleeping bags, inflatable mattresses, hammocks are great options. Flashlight with extra batteries. Again, if there's no power, when the sun goes down, there's no light except for what you make or what you have. So a flashlight, being able to start a fire and keep a fire going, having small bills of cash. When it comes down to it, having the ability to buy things without using a credit card or internet or electricity to pay for it can make a huge difference. Having an extra supply of medications. And this is one of by far the most difficult things about getting prepared is building an extra supply of medications. And there's a few different ways that we encourage people to do that. Being very diligent on getting refills and trying to save one or two each time. Looking at the newer laws that pass that allow you to get extra supply of medication and hopefully working with your medical professionals to build an extra supply of medication. But keeping records of your medications as well is a great way that if you can't build a supply, when medications and resources start showing up from the government, you can show, these are the medications I take in these dosages, please give me some. If you wear glasses, having an extra pair of glasses or contacts in your kits, your emergency kits, whether it's your car, at work, outside your home, inside your home, can really make a huge difference because your glasses, you know, having one pair of glasses that if it happens at night and you take them off and you put them on your nightstand, they might not be there if everything's shaking. Having a good pair of work gloves. One of the great opportunities I've had was I spent 45 days in Puerto Rico after Hurricanes Irma and Maria. Some of the most treated injuries we saw there were hand injuries because people cut their hands digging through their homes to get their stuff. Now, if we don't have ability to get to the hospital or access significant medical care, making sure that you don't cut your hands or your feet or get injured is incredibly important. So having a good pair of work gloves that fit you and you know you can actually dig through and do some hard work with them is incredibly important. This is by far one of the things that I will recommend to everybody is just have a good pair of gloves. Other useful items that you may enjoy or make your life a little bit more comfortable is having candles, a way of light, or a fire source. How would you start a fire or start a cooking fire if necessary? Having waterproof bags or trash bags. Having some tools. Now, again, this goes back to if you were going to try to make your home a shelter, you know, whether it's one room or multiple rooms, but having the example I have here is plastic sheets and duct tape. If you lost the glass, the windows to your home, if you had some plastic sheeting, you'd be able to tape up those windows and actually potentially re-insulate. If you'd put plastic sheeting on the outside, put some blankets on the inside, and then taped up another layer on the inside, and essentially rebuilt a wall using plastic sheeting and blankets. That's a great option to re-insulate your home so you could actually stay in it, especially if the weather's not great for being outside. Now, having a radio, whether it's battery or hand crank, is another great tip because we do have the ability to send out localized AM stations, FM stations, and there's a number of news stations in the area that have already agreed to and are willing to partner with us as we start setting up shelters and setting up resources to project that information out over the radio network. So having somebody that could turn on a radio or get a hand crank radio that has that ability can be incredibly useful. Having a fire extinguisher and knowing how to use it. If you are one of those people that have a fire extinguisher and it's been in your home for 1 to 5 years and you haven't checked to see if it's expired or if there's still pressure in it, please do so now. Pause this video, go check on that, or do it after. But testing a fire extinguisher, once you pull that pin and you depress it, you can't put the pin back in, it's not gonna last the charge. But getting a new fire extinguisher or having it recharged is not expensive, especially when it comes to something that could save your life or save your home. I highly encourage you to learn how to use, whether it's on YouTube or you take a cert class, learn how to use a fire extinguisher. All right. Some other documents that you should seriously consider, and this goes back to, I mentioned a few documents earlier, but having those telephone numbers written down, having copies of IDs, having pictures of you with your family and pets. Now, for those of you with children, in your child's backpack, in a Ziploc bag, you should seriously consider having a folded up or just have a piece of paper with your entire family portrait in it. The pictures of you and your whole family with your adult name that other adults call you, your phone number, and your address. Because if you have a 6 or 7 year old and I've met them on the street because they were wandering around lost, could they effectively describe you so that I could help find you? Often you get some funny answers and some funny descriptions. So having a photo, if they could pull it out and say, this is a photo of me and my family, I'm looking for these people, this is our address, and this is their phone number. That helps responders. That helps us identify the people that should be able to take care of them. And maybe it's not just your family, but anybody else that will take care of them. Have that picture of them in a bag, Ziploc bag, inside that child's backpack. I've already talked about medications a couple times. Think about those medical conditions or allergies you have, and I'll talk about that more here in a few slides. Let's see, and really consider updating this on a regular basis. As I mentioned, one of the steps to disaster preparedness is preparing and maintaining your kit and your documentation. So if your children move from one school to the next, does that plan change? Are they now a few more miles away? Do they have their own car? Do they have a sibling that's not at the same school now or at a local school? Have those considerations and make sure you update that whole family plan. Think about how you would carry or transport this, whether it's in a backpack or a wagon. Anything with wheels, like I mentioned before, a suitcase, an empty suitcase that's sitting in your house right now could be a great option. A trash bin, a large plastic trash bin. They make a lot of noise when they roll, but that lets you take everything with you. Think about shelter, whether it's a tent, tarps, plastic sheeting, bug nets, vehicles. We know right now in Puerto Rico, after several of these earthquakes that have happened over the last 10 days, there is a pretty large portion of the population that is living out of their cars right now because it provides shelter from the weather, the insects, and everything else, and lets them kind of secure their belongings. So having that as a consideration should be part of your plan. Think about where you store your kit. And there is no one solution for everybody. The way I do it may not work for anybody else. But really consider how you're going to pack and transport or secure and gather your supplies. So for us at my house, I have a lot of stuff in my garage, but I also have a few things in my shed. So that lets me, if I had to, I could stay in my shed for a couple days as I dig out the rest of my home and get into the rest of the supplies in my garage. So having that as a consideration is just one thing that works for me. Now, if you live in an apartment or a condo, or you don't have the amount of space that you'd like to build those supplies, have a little bit in your car. Have more in your home. Have a plan with the people in your area or your neighborhood on how you could help each other. You know, think about how could you get it from a damaged or collapsed building. We know that historically during earthquakes, most wood-framed or stick-built buildings do pretty well. Now, a lot of glass will break, a lot of your appliances move, big things shift. But overwhelmingly, people survive and stick-built wood-frame homes do pretty well. So having that plan on who's coming to you, who's going to help you, and then the last two bullets here, and this is really two mindsets of it, is put as much together in one safe space as possible so that way you know you have one goal to get to everything, or spread it out and around your home. And this goes back to what do you already have around your home? You may have a pantry and cabinets, and you may have a little bit of supply in your garage. So across that the whole area of your home, you may have 15 to 20 to 30 days of food or canned food on hand. Spread out throughout your home because that's the way it fits and that's the way it works for you. So make sure you plan that and you have that as consideration, that what works for one person doesn't work for everybody. Here's one of the more difficult things to also discuss. And it's the fact that the sewer systems will likely be damaged or destroyed. So how do we deal with disaster sanitation? And this system here is the twin bucket system. And this came out of several emergency events, including the earthquakes that rocked New Zealand. And this is also part of the Regional Disaster Preparedness Office's plan for helping Portland and largely populated areas deal with this sanitation system or sanitation issue after a cascadia type event. And as you can read the slides, it's two buckets. You have your liquid bucket and your solid bucket. And one of the really important things is each time you use a solids bucket to cover it up with something that helps absorb the moisture. As there's less moisture, it won't smell as bad. Still not gonna be our favorite thing to go around, but it will help. My personal things that I always recommend not to forget are hand sanitizer and soap. Again, keeping clean. Keeping clean and not spreading disease and helping yourself. Toilet paper. If you want to see a lot of angry people, take away all the toilet paper. Toilet paper will be worth more than gold, so stocking up on it now is always a great option. Feminine products and can liners are also things to seriously consider. Again, can liners are for the solids bucket, which you don't want to run out of those. And personally for me, I spent the extra $12 to get the clip-on toilet seat that clips onto one of the 5-gallon buckets because I think it's worth it. I've seen people use pool noodles or other options. I just found it worth it to get the extra clip-on toilet seat. Think about wherever you are, and I already talked about this a little bit, but we consider this part of your get-home kit. So having a get-home kit in your car, whether it's a backpack or a suitcase, but have water, snacks, food, a little first aid kit, some extra medications, a flashlight, an extra change of shoes or socks. Personally, I wear boots for work every day, or I generally wear shoes that I could walk home in every day. So in my car, I really just keep an extra pair of socks. Keeping your tank half full. This sounds interesting and incredibly annoying, but when it comes down to it, if there's no power, you may not be able to pay for gas with a credit card, but the gas pumps may also not work. So keeping your tank at least half full, because if the roads are passable and they do work, you can at least make sure that you can drive a little bit with it. If you play the empty game, here's a great reason to not. Play the half full game. Every time you get to half full, stop by. It's less time spent at the gas station, but more trips. But it's absolutely worth it when it comes down to it, because this might also be the gas that gets siphoned out to run a generator that helps save somebody's life. So again, helping each other. Other things for our day-to-day emergencies, have reflectors and flashers. Have a spare tire and know how to change it, or run flat, fix a flat option is a great thing to have in your car. One other thing that I always like to point out on this slide is road flares, because road flares can start a fire in just about any condition. They burn at about 2,000 degrees, and even if it's wet and rainy, you can generally start a fire with them. It's a great option. Think about when you're at work. Have a little backpack or a tote or something underneath your desk with a little bit of water, some snacks or a solid meal in there. I personally have an MRE and a gallon of water underneath my desk. I don't have medications. I don't particularly need them. I do have some Advil. Having sturdy shoes, depending on the shoes that you wear at work, flashlight and a whistle. Now, a whistle is a big thing depending on where you work. We know historically from other earthquake events throughout the world that having a whistle can really help save lives. We know that for example, in Mexico, there have been earthquakes where people have been trapped and been 10 feet away from a wall where first responders were, but they had yelled so much over the first 10 hours that they lost their voice and quite literally couldn't yell for help anymore when responders actually got close enough to them. So a whistle requires no voice and they're small. So having one and being able to blow it when you hear people, or the other thing we say is if you're trapped, try to tap on metal or pipes, because they travel a lot longer and that sound will carry. But having a whistle, very easy to have one on your desk, tape it underneath your desk, put it in your little kit. Very simple thing to have that can really save lives. When we talk about children, get them involved. Give them their own go bag. Have snacks and food that they like. I know hunger is the greatest flavor packet, but have food that people like. When it comes to emergency food as well, I always encourage you to have some hot sauce. Put a bottle of hot sauce in your kit. If you got rice and beans, get a bottle of hot sauce to throw in there too. Just a great thing to add a little bit of flavor, but have their comfort items for children. Have stuffed animals, blankets, toys, things that will make them comfortable, and games. Because although you may be working to clean up your home and recover from this disaster, it's gonna be hard to keep kids engaged. So giving them something to do and getting them engaged can really make a huge difference. Now, also, if necessary, diapers and cleaning equipment. If you have small children that require diapers, make sure you have enough for them for at least 2 weeks, if not more. When it comes to pets, pets don't have the option to prepare. So we always try to make sure that we take care of them. They rely on us completely. So have extra food and water, have little collapsible bowls or emergency bowls. Have something that they're used to, whether it's a kennel, a carrier, a blanket, or a bed, something that they can be comfortable going to and kind of recovering at, because pets often have trauma too. Have an extra collar or a leash, whether it sounds weird, but have a cat collar and a leash for your cat. We personally have an extra collar and leash for our dog that's underneath our front steps. So if we had to, if we were running out of the house, one of the first things we can do is grab it and secure our dog. Have toys that they like. Have medical records or medications that your pets may need. And then have some cleaning supplies. One of the biggest problems in a lot of shelters is that people can't clean up after their pets. So in some shelters, especially if they're privately run, there are some authorizations for some of the shelters that don't have to let you bring your pet in unless you can prove that it's vaccinated and that you can clean up after it. Now, those are few and far between, but if you were living in a shelter, wouldn't you want the people next to you to be able to pick up their pet's waste if it ended up next to your bed or your living space? I would hope so. So have that consideration. Also, current photos in case they're separated. Again, goes with that family photo for a kid's backpack or just in your regular work bag. Have it in your car. Having those pieces of information in those photos really can make a huge difference. When it comes to aging and elderly, make sure you plan for them too. Make sure you have planning for aging and elderly. And this last bullet on this slide is just happen to fit really well here, but keep copies of pre-printed messages that explain needs and how to best communicate, especially if you have people that have medical issues or other fears or other problems. Make sure that we have what your daily schedule is. Make sure we have the ability to help if we met this person. Batteries for any devices, and this is a big thing, especially when you get into medical conditions. But batteries for devices can be incredibly useful, especially if you know somebody who has, for example, a CPAP machine. Sleeping next to a generator isn't great. You may not have a generator, so if you have somebody or you know somebody who has a CPAP machine and they require it every night for essentially life-saving measures, what is their plan for it? There's generators, there's quiet generators, there's solar power generators and solar panels. Make sure you have a plan for things like that. When it comes to medical conditions, make sure you keep a list of your medical conditions and status and medications with you on a regular basis. If you have to keep medications refrigerated, have a plan for that or how you'll keep them cold. Have a plan if your home health care giver can't get to you because they may be separated and it may not be an option. One of the things that I always encourage is know the local facilities that can support your life-sustaining needs. If you have to go to a medical appointment on a regular basis, make sure you know all of the places around you that could potentially provide that. Even if it's private medications, private practices, know where those facilities are in relation to you. Because if you can't get to your regular service provider, your regular appointments, you may need to find somebody nearby that can help. So making sure you have a list of those locations and knowing it can really make a huge difference. Now, as I've said, practice and maintain plans every 6 months. Do fire evacuation drills more than once every 5 years, please. Please. Test and recharge extinguishers. Have a practice, learn how to do that. Check expiration date of food and products. Now, this is something that people say they don't get prepared because doing a rotation on food is time consuming. There's really clever ways of doing that, and there's really clever ways of building it. And then also changing over your clothes in your bag depending on the season. If you build your kit in July and you put shorts in it and you haven't put rain pants or a warm coat and it's December and something happens, you're going to be a little uncomfortable. So having that consideration. One of the most important things, and I've referred to this a number of times, is being a resilient community. And this is something that we see time and time again, that overwhelmingly in bad situations, people come together to help. So you being prepared to help not only the people you love and you care about, your neighbors, but also the other people in your neighborhood, in your community, whether it's your church, your association or club, your families, your ultimate frisbee team, your D&D club, whoever it is that you associate with and you're close to. Make a community out of it and have this conversation with them. Have a little bit of preparedness conversation with them. Because although I talked about doing and getting all of these supplies and kits, one of the easiest ways to do it is do it a little bit over time. The Red Cross is a great partner, and they have the Red Cross Prepare Guide. In the middle of the Prepare Guide, they actually have a 24-week calendar on how to build a kit 1 week at a time, a little bit at a time. And the City of Salem, we actually went through our 2 weeks ready program, and we had employees actually follow that calendar and go through that bit by bit to build their preparedness kits at home. And they had a lot of great lessons learned, and you can go hop onto our social media pages and the city's website to follow along. On the city's website and 2 weeks ready campaign, you can also find the prepare guide in a digital format. You can find the calendar, and then you can also sign up for emails that you'll get every week for 24 weeks to show you how to get prepared over time. So other things that I recommend is assign tasks, give people something to do. Who's gonna be that person that goes out into the neighborhood and helps bring other people back to build a larger community? There's always strength in numbers in any type of disaster, and living together can really help protect people and also take care of people that need it. There are plenty of people in our community that will need help in any type of situation. So being able to help each other really makes that difference. And again, going back to one of the first things that I asked is, wouldn't you want the people nearby to be able to help your family if you couldn't get there until you're reunited with them? I would hope so. And that's why I plan to help the people in my area and why we have a plan with our whole neighborhood. Consider planning in a larger scale with more people. Now, the quick thing of what to do in an actual disaster. And this is something that we go through all the time. And when it comes to earthquakes, this is the national and international best standard, is drop, cover, and hold. And quite literally, it's drop to the ground, find some cover for at least your head, neck, and shoulders, and hold on. You're going for a ride. Now, if you're outdoors, try to stay away from things that may fall on you. And this is one of the recommendations. People often say, well, I'm going to run outside. I'm going to get away from the building I'm in. If you run outside, the rest of the building, the glass that may break and fall out, the parapets and the brick masonry may come flying off and actually injure you. Fairly frequently, the things that injure people in earthquakes or hurt and kill people are pieces of building falling on them, glass falling on them, or them tripping while they're trying to run. So finding appropriate cover and holding on is the quite literally international best standard of how to save yourself and protect yourself. Now, if you're outdoors, try to stay away from things that may fall on you. If you're driving or in a car, please don't stop on or under a bridge or overpass. Try to get past that and try to stay in your car until shaking stops. Cars, you can find plenty of videos of it online. Cars will shake a lot, but overwhelmingly, they do pretty well in earthquakes, and they have some safety measures like airbags and other things that may, if you are impacted or your vehicle is impacted, may save your life. So consider that. When it comes to earthquake safety, you know, be prepared for aftershocks. They happen frequently, or they could be a while. Most injuries, as we said, come from collapsing walls, flying glass, and objects. So make sure you do that home hazard hunt I spoke about earlier. Look at how to secure things to the wall, TVs, bookcases, anything else that may fall. One of our favorite things to recommend is put an extra pair of shoes with a flashlight in one shoe, extra pair of glasses in another shoe, and put them in a bag, whether it's a string bag, an old backpack, or just tie the shoes directly to your bed. Because when an earthquake happens, if you're in bed, you're probably going for a little ride, and you can roll over and cover your head, neck, and shoulders, because hopefully you don't have a lot over your bed. Can be relatively safe, but then as you get up, you can reach down, untie your shoes, click on your flashlight, put your glasses on, and put your shoes on so you can get out of your home without stepping on broken glass and causing more injury to yourself. Turning off gas and utilities can be a great skill to learn. I highly encourage you to learn it. One of the tips is having a wrench that you could actually turn off your gas meter with. Now, we only say turn off your gas meter if you can actively hear hissing or you can smell gas in a strong way. Automatic shutoff valves will be turning off throughout the entire region. However, the gas that's in your home could still cause a fire and cause additional issues and damage. Personally, if you feel like it's safe to do so, have the appropriate wrench near your gas meter. Now make sure it's secured in some way that not anybody can just walk up and turn off your gas, because that can cause a problem with the gas company. But have a consideration on how you would actually have a wrench in a timely manner to turn off that gas to your home. When it comes to flood safety, one of the things that we always ask is please follow instructions. Turn around, don't drown is one of our great tips that came out of the southwest region of the United States, where they saw flash floods and people were driving through floods thinking they could get through it. But when you think about it, your gas tank is actually a big floater on the bottom of your car, especially if it's empty or low on fuel. So most cars will stall in 1 foot of water and start floating at about 2. So one of the other big considerations is don't allow children to play in flooded streets. And we've seen this even here in Salem a couple times, where the storm pressure was so high that it actually lifted the round storm drain covers and create a flow. Now, if a child accidentally runs into that, they may get sucked under and they will be pulled in through the system. And there's really no good way of getting them out. So please make sure you be aware of where your children are playing and where storm drains may be or may have lifted up. Always consider preparing sandbags before a storm. And the city of Salem, we provide sandbags several days out. So you can get free sandbags from the city and they will provide those at Public Works. Now, two other things that we always recommend people to do is sign up for the city alerts. Now, the cityofsalem.net/getcommunityalerts, /pages/getcommunityalerts. This is our community alerts that are voluntary. So if we have an event going on, we can reach out and tell you, especially in your area, because it has you register your actual location. So if we had a fire in a certain area or we were closing roads for a specific event, we could actually send those out. And if you're registered in that area, it would reach out and tell you. Now, flash alert is just another great way of keeping up with the city and understanding why we've done events like we put this road closure up for maintenance or because there was a rock slide or this is in lockdown because police are investigating the area. There's plenty of reasons why we do that, and flash alert is something that we always use when we have a closure or an event like that. So with all of that being said, please consider being 2 weeks ready, be prepared, because you never know what's coming and we never know when. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please feel free to email me or call me. My contact information is here. It's gwalsh@cityofsalem.net. And if you're interested in having me come do a presentation like this or this presentation to your group or organization, please reach out to me. I'm happy to do so. And if you're interested in getting prepared or getting more prepared, please look at the cityofsalem.net/emergencies for how to sign up for CERT training. And you can also find the 2 weeks ready program linked from that site. So thank you very much. Please get prepared.